some end. I'll shake it about simply to disperse it, something that's done in older cars in the carburetor and in modern cars through the fuel injection systems. But we want to disperse the fuel vapor with the air containing the 21% oxygen. Now remember, this is an explosion because we have the oxygen and the fuel pre-mixed. I'll supply the spark with this device. It's known as a Tesla coil. If you want some interesting reading, or back to some of the PBS programs, Edison and Tesla, they were the pioneers of the electrical world that we have today. But we'll touch this. My hands are involved, so I'm going to have to use the muffs and protect your ears. Protect your ears. And here we go down the road. Invented the electric starter. This was one of the major technical add-ons for automobiles, and we won't talk about all the things that allowed. He sold his patent rights to Cadillac. Cadillac merged into General Motors. General Motors made Kettering their director of research and development. He moved up to Detroit, but many times in his career, he would come back to the city of Dayton to discuss problems with his inventor friends, one of whom was a chemist by the name of Thomas Midgley, who actually helped him solve two of the most important ones. We're going to demonstrate one of them now. This is a clear plastic jug. I need actually to be more frightened of shattering with this. Clearness in plastic implies a certain amount of brittleness, just like glass. Now, what Thomas Midgley came up with was an additive to smooth out the explosions. Because in a car engine, you don't want a lot of shaking and bouncing. And to smooth it out, the oil companies started cracking the gasoline, which brought on the term octane ratings. And Midgley came up with an additive to smooth out the combustion. For a push in a piston, you want a slow pushing reaction. And this will be an open container, so we won't have a loud boom. But we'll have to take the lights down because the alcohols burn with a blue flame, which is otherwise almost impossible to notice. Now remember, what we would like is a smooth push and fast out. But with regular gasoline, what we got was a very forceful thrust with a lot of pre and post ignition.
A lot.
Okay. So I've got to switch to another bottle. We've used up most of the oxygen from the air. That is the limiting reagent. That's why we have the four-cycle engine to exhaust the burnt gases and allow a fresh entrance. This time I'm going to use 70% isopropanol, rubbing alcohol. So we'll put some in, I'll shake it about, pour out the excess, and then repeat the experiment, but show you how a high-octane fuel with anti-knock additives, actually where we get the term ethyl gasolines, works. We'll put that behind again. And find my taper. Remember, we want a smooth, slow push on the piston. No piston in this case, but a slow explosion. Whoops. Wait a minute, I lost my wire. There we go. So compare this to the last one and see if this is.
I'm trying to remember what that one is, but I know what that one is.
Rare chemical reaction. If you look at the Erlenmeyer flask, you'll see that there's a white crystalline solid in that flask. I'm going to add to that white crystalline solid another white crystalline solid, and let's notice what happens. Now, the reactions that Joan just did, the explosions in the flask, those are vapor-vapor or gas phase reactions. The one that I'm doing here is a rather rare reaction because it's a solid-solid reaction. Now, one of the products of this reaction is actually liquid water. So I'll get this all mixed up there, and if you look at that closely now, you can see that there's kind of a slurry of those salts inside the flask. The explosion reactions that John did, the candle flames, the hydrogen balloons, all of those are exothermic reactions. They give off heat energy. This reaction is an endothermic reaction. It absorbs heat. In fact, it's going to absorb enough heat to freeze solidly to this block of wood. So I just put some water on the block of wood. I'll put the flask on top of it. This takes maybe a minute or two to freeze to the block of wood. So while that's going on, I'm going to show you a little known property of glass and also something about electrical circuits. So on this circuit board, I have two light bulbs that are connected in series. What that means is that if I unscrew one light bulb, I've broken the circuit and the other bulb goes out. So if I unscrew this one, I break the circuit also. Well, let's continue with this. I'll unplug for safety here, put it back in the board, take one of the light bulbs out, wrap it up carefully in a bunch of paper towels, use my side cutter pliers here to break the light bulb, and I've got that nicely broken. Now I'm going to use the side cutter pliers to cut off the little capsule that's at the top of the light bulb. We get that going there. We get that side cut off. Now I'll cut the other side off. Once we get that one off, it requires to work properly here. Sometimes, yep, there it is. We have that off. Now I'm just going to screw that broken light bulb into this socket, but it's a porcelain socket, which means that it will
work, it won't get messy under heat. And now what I'm going to do is just plug this in. And you notice, of course, that the light bulb doesn't go on because this bulb is broken. Well, that little known property of glass is that when glass is in the molten state, glass actually becomes a semiconductor, and I'm using the propane torch to heat up the glass to that molten state. So it's that glass now that you can see that's glowing over there that's actually conducting the electricity so the other bulb is on. An interesting little property of glass. Well, we'll unplug here and come over to this. Thank you. And notice that this is actually frozen to the block of wood. I'm going to clamp this flask up rather high. If we get it clamped up, I'll just put it over here on the side on the table so you can look at this from time to time. It'll actually stay frozen to the block of wood at least until the end of the show. John?
Yes. Sometimes I'm accused of overemphasizing fires and explosions for the gee whiz effect. But in fact, fire was man's first and greatest chemical invention. Before recorded history, it was used to warm his home, cook his food, light the knife. As history started on, refining metals, first copper and iron, and then more exotic ones, and produced many other inventions on up to the locomotion type ones with the steam engine and then the internal combustion engine and such. Well, nature is a good pattern for scientists to look to when we want ideas. And long before even fire, low depth fish and some insects and that produce light without fire, without heat, without the flames. And we only about 100 years ago learned how to do that. So here is some chemiluminescence. Luminescence from chemistry without combustion. In addition to chemiluminescence, in the last century, we also duplicated things like fluorescent rocks that are found in nature and geology to give us aspects of electroluminescence and photoluminescence using something like UV light. Well, the development along those lines also brought on various types of semiconductor bulbs and such. And let's just see how important such things are to us. If you look carefully, you may see these red lights flickering. But if I spin this faster than the eye can see, we have a full image. Thank you. So with such things, without such things, you wouldn't have TVs, you wouldn't have movies, you wouldn't have computer screens and such. But this also shows that sometimes it's good that we aren't the fastest. Because our eye is slower, we can see the superposition of that and allow inventions that make use of that slowness.
Right, Ruben? Thank you, John. That was illuminating. We may not be aware that you actually live at the bottom of an ocean of air. Atmospheric pressure is all around us, and we have a little demonstration
here tell that. I have an Erlenmeyer flask and a hard-boiled egg. The hard-boiled egg is too large to go in the flask. John is soaking some puff balls in alcohol. When he finishes that and ignites them, he's going to put them down in the flask. As soon as he does, I will put the egg on top of the flask and then notice what's happening. So, what happened there? Has the alcohol burned, it used up the oxygen in the flask, and it also heated up the air, increasing the pressure. The egg then served as a one-way valve, letting the hot air out, but all the oxygen was used up, the flame went out, the air in the flask cooled down, the pressure of the flask decreased, and atmospheric pressure actually pushed the egg down into the flask. Well, the next question might be, how can we get that egg out of the flask without destroying the egg or the flask? Well, if I had enough lung power, I could actually blow past the egg, increase the pressure, and blow it out, but I'm pretty old, can't do that anymore. So we're going to do a different way. I'm going to put the flask upside down here, and now I'm going to heat up the air in the flask very carefully and slowly with the propane torch. This will increase the gas pressure in the flask, and when we get that pressure up high enough, it will actually force the egg out, and there it is. The egg has just popped out, and I've laid another egg. Well, now, we can do this demonstration in quite the, what might be a more interesting way. I have some gelatin dessert in my hand here. I'm going to take that gelatin dessert and put it into this special apparatus. As soon as John gets the cotton ball,